This video is a little lengthy. It's going to actually go through most of the cloning products in the industry, and we're going to break down what's in them, how they work, everything along those lines. But on just a quick down and dirty fast before we get into all of that, I'm going to tell you the cheapest and most inexpensive way of cloning in the industry where you literally will never purchase another cloning product again. So what I would personally recommend doing is to mix up a gallon of water with drops balance. If you're using tap water, 5 mLs per gallon. If you're using RO water, do 2.5 mLs per gallon. This is a specific instructions for cloning. After you make up that concentration of drops balance in water, you're going to use it that as like a dipping, or where you're after you cut and you put your clones into a specific cup and they wait for prior to cloning. That will be the water that those clones sit in and wait for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, whatever it is. Then you're going to want to crack a couple eggs. Obviously, if you grow your own chickens, it's going to be even better. But after you crack it, just mix up the yellow and the white part of it. And then that's going to be your cloning shell. I give you my word, use the drops balance for the water soak and eggs for your dip. As long as it's semi-healthy, you're going to get 100% success. They're going to grow stronger and you're never going to purchase another cloning material again. The reason why is because the yolk is made up of life. I mean, literally, think about it for a second. Those yolks produce a chicken that go on to produce more eggs in life, right? That's the strongest essence of everything. It's going to have all the minerals, enzymes. It's going to have so many different things in there that want to produce life.
Okay, so any of you guys that follow my channel, you know I love my Excel spreadsheet. All I did was I pulled up some of the most known cloning gels in the hydroponic industry. We have Clonac, Drops Balance, Dynagro, Imec, Clone Gel, Olivia's, Root Tech, and Dip and Grow. And what I did was turn the bottle around and I pulled out what was in it. Clonex. Clonex actually doesn't have what's in it on the label anymore. I looked all over the internet, but if I remember straight, because I owned a hydroponic store, a 9,000 square foot hydroponic store for almost a decade, if I remember straight, it's vitamin D and butyric acid. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through one by one by one by one, referencing different things, and I'm going to reference back to the sheet of what is in each of these products, and then we're going to talk about it a little bit. Okay, so first one, as you can see, vitamin B1, vitamin B1. Okay, so right here, vitamin B1 for plants. Vitamin B1 is that miracle drug that makes all plants grow bigger, especially after transplanting. Then we scroll down a little bit. The history of this myth is quite interesting and told in detail here. I'll make sure to include the link down below. In 1930, a scientist noticed that B vitamins stimulated root growth in a petri dish in a lab. A few more tests and people started becoming convinced that it was the greatest thing since sliced bread. In 1939, Better Homes and Gardens published a report that showed vitamin B1 resulted in huge rose flowers and giant daffodils, among others. The myth was launched and fed on itself. After all, if Better Homes and Gardens said it's true, it has to be true. By 1942, even the original author of the study admitted that vitamin B1 had no positive effect on plant growth and said it is now certain, however, that additions of B vitamin to intact growing plants have no significant or useful place in horticulture or agriculture practice. But it was too late. So let's go ahead and go back to the Excel spreadsheet, right? What does this initially tell me when I see products that have B vitamin? And once again, we have to double check Clonex, so I'm pretty sure it does have it. What does it tell me? Well, it tells me that these companies that are producing a product specifically for Clonex, right? All you have to do is just Google it and read a couple of viewpoints. They're making products. They're the leaders in the industry, yet they're putting a product in their cloning gel that for over 70 years is a known fact that there is no benefit in cloning and possibly in agriculture at all to help alleviate stress. So instantly, I probably wouldn't buy a product from Clonex or Root Tech just because I would think that they're kind of adding products onto their product line or the brand name through private labeling, or they have someone in their product creation department that's just creating products to make money and for a bottom line. It's really not the benefit of the grower, but the benefit of the corporation. Let's go ahead and go to the second one. Before that, though, I will also, at the end of this, show you clone experiments done with tap water, Clonex, and drops of balance. But go ahead and stay tuned to the end. IVA. It's a rooting hormone. And this is a website where you can actually get it in a powder, which is a more stable form than in a liquid. And I'm going to come here on the description. Butyric acid is a plant hormone that is found in diluted form in most commercial rooting products. It is also found naturally in white willow, which is also used to root plants. Also known as IBA, butyric acid is used to clone plants from cuttings and in tissue culture. Commercial rooting powders typically have a dilution of 0.1 to 0.4. This is a 90% pure product, so it can be diluted down to yield a lot of product. IBA is insoluble in water, so it must be dissolved in 75% isopropyl alcohol and added to water. The final solution should range from 10,000 to 50,000 parts per million. Once mixed in solution, IVA should be used within a few days. Okay, so what does this tell me, right? IVA, once mixed in solution, and that's obviously mixed in alcohol and water. And once it's mixed in alcohol and water, it should be used in a few days. So let's go ahead and go up to these product lines real quick, and I'm going to show you what I have discovered. I could be wrong, but I don't think I am. Okay, so you can see Dynagrow right here, right? So you have the butyric acid, and then you have the NAA. I can't say that word, but that's the NAA is what this is. And then you have other ingredients. So other ingredient most likely is the alcohol or the solvent that is needed for this acid to become more of a water-soluble product so that it actually can work. So guys, if you guys want to use this product, you can buy it really inexpensively on a powder and then mix your own rooting shell. The issue I have with this, though, is right there on this website, they are telling you that you should use this product after mix. And most likely, it begins to probably break down. And I could be wrong on this, but I'm just thinking, and it's probably once in a more soluble form, it probably begins to biodegrade because of temperature fluctuations and whatever else they're putting in. I could be wrong once again. Although when I see that, and I see it in Clonex, and I see it in Dynagrow, and I see it in RootTech, I begin to wonder what the shelf life is on each of these products and how long they have been in the hydroponic stores, how long were they in the warehouses before they were sold to the hydroponic stores and then sold to the end consumer. When was this batch made? Was it made the year before to fulfill large orders normally placed in the beginning of the year? And me beginning to formulate these questions in my mind just through some basic research, wondering if the product even should be sold in the form it is being sold in. Obviously, they're using this product because they can buy it super cheap, mark it up like crazy, sell it out, which it's business. You know what I mean? If you're not willing to educate yourself, it's going to cost you something. The next one is the NAA. So let's go and take a look at that real quick. NAA is an organic compound with the formula of this. So just to be really clear, when someone says organic, that just means it has carbon-hydrogen bonds in it, okay? Doesn't mean that it's organic. It's a completely different meaning. NAA is a synthetic plant hormone, synthetic being that it was man-made. It had been altered. It's a plant hormone in the auxin family, and it is an ingredient to many commercial plant rooting hydrocultural products. It is a rooting agent and is used for the vegetative propagation of plants for stems and leaf cuttings. It is also used for plant tissue culture. The hormone NAA does not occur naturally. It is toxic to plants in high concentration. Right when I got to editing the remainder of this video, Pete from MX Gels contacted me, and he ended up telling me that MX Clone Gel has butyric acid, it has water, xanthium gum, which all that is sugar that was fermented by bacteria. And it is a thickening agent because they want to thicken up their product and sell it as a gel versus as a liquid. And then they say that they put a proprietary antifungal agent in that. As you can tell, 5 of the 7 main cloning products that you can use on the market for cloning right now use the butyric acid. So in this situation, we have Dynagrow and Different Grow. If I had to pick between either this one or Different Grow, I'd probably pick Different Grow. The reason why I would pick Different Grow over this one, I know they have both have formulations, is because anyone that has used Different Grow actually knows that you have to dilute this product with the water before using it. So it tells me that most likely they're using a solvent that has not already been diluted with water. I could be wrong. Once again, Dynagrow, they're using a gel, same with Flonex. So it goes back to the same reference as before. How long has the product been on the shelf before it gets sold to the consumer and before it's used? As you can see, though, Clonex and Rutech are the same product. Dynagrow and Divigrow are the same product. The next two products is Olivia Clonin Gel. So Olivia Clonin Gel has ammonical nitrogen. I can never say this word. I apologize, guys. It has nitrate, nitrogen, phosphate, and potash. So think about it, guys. We have four companies that are using hormones. Two of those four companies are using Z vitamin that has no apparent value. And then we have Olivia gels that is using basically nitrogen. This one's actually the good nitrogen. The bacteria break it down and it becomes a nitrate. This one isn't totally my favorite, but it's kind of like the second best. And then you have the phosphate and the potash, which I'll bring these up real quick. I thought some interesting stuff came from this. As you see right here, these ions are nitrified and are converted by microorganisms into nitrate. That's why I actually prefer this type of nitrogen if I'm going to use a fertilizer phase. Nitrates are a little bit more readily available to the plant because they are more readily available, slightly more toxic to the natural environment. Then you have the phosphate, which is mined from the earth, which this is something I think is a lot more beneficial than using a salt-based fertilizer. The last one is potash, which this was, I thought, very interesting to point out to you guys. So in this article right here, it references two types of potash. There's the sulfate of potash, and then there's the chloride in this type of potash. At the end of the day, you have to be a little bit more aware. And sometimes people are selling this type of crap on the market right here when you want to be using sulfate of potash versus the chloride, because this right here shuts down your microbiology. It is what is actually left behind in your water after the chlorine off-gases. Either way, it's still a salt that ends up screwing up your microbiology. Still though, you're going to find different types of potash in the fertilizers throughout this entire industry. And most of these guys have no idea. They just look at the bottom line. And because one's a little more expensive and they don't understand why, and they believe the salesman that comes to them and says, hey, it's the same thing, and you're going to save X, Y, and Z, they end up taking the cheaper product because they're just not as knowledgeable. So let's go and bring back up the Excel spreadsheet, right? Olivia is not using any hormones. They're just using a little bit of basic fertilizer to clone your plant. And so what does this mean here, right? That means that your plants don't need any special hormones or stress relievers or whatever. This is a very well-known company that's been around for, what, two decades, three decades? And they're just giving a little bit of light fertilizer to your plant. Now let's go and look at Drops of Balance. Drops of Balance has 34 to 50 plus ionic sulfate of minerals. Let's go ahead and look at about what sulfur and iron and magnesium and potassium and barium and calcium and sodium and silicon and germanium and zinc and magnesium and so on and so on and so on do for your plant. Okay, because let's just point out real quick. So if Olivia's is just adding a little bit of fertilizer to the stem and they're saying that this is cloning gel, that means that plants should have no issue cloning in good, clean water that have trace minerals. Trace minerals are fertilizer. We can call them back and forth. They're the same thing. So let's come back over here and talk about what those things do for you. First one, sulfur. I bet a lot of you guys have seen sulfur deficiencies. The light coloring the leaves, don't get it confused for when your plants go into flowering, because this also kind of similarly looks like it gets a little light in the center. Sulfur is as necessary as the phosphorus. It is considered an essential mineral. Sulfur in plants help form important enzymes and assist in the formation of plant proteins. So what is that? Plant proteins are the DNA of the plants, the building blocks. Here's another picture showing right here that the macro, the secondary elements, and the micro elements, people are still not really comprehending how important trace minerals are to this whole component of things. Iron, right here, But if a lot of you guys have seen this, it starts to come up looking like a magnesium deficiency. So you might want to go get magnesium and calcium. But if you don't notice that you don't have the blotching that the calcium creates in the center, you are going to misdiagnose the plan and you actually have an iron deficiency versus a CalMag deficiency. So right here, what am I saying here, right? Iron is essential for plants. Sulfur is essential for plants. Another one, how to use aluminum sulfate to lower soil pH. Let's go over here back to the Excel spreadsheet. Drops of Balance has all these minerals. So a few years ago, I did an experiment with Clonec, Drops of Balance, and regular tap water. And the first picture you're seeing right here, obviously you can see it's a Clonec. Obviously it's purple. Anyone that knows Clonec knows purple. All I did was cut the plant, dip it in the material, and I put it in a cup of water. As you see right here, nubs are starting to form on the Clonec. So I'm not saying that Clonec doesn't work. I'm just showing. So this one right here, obviously, is the Clonec. And these two right here are the Drop of Balance. I then want to point up the one that had just intact water right here. As you can see right here, as you come in close, though, this is the one on the tap water. The interesting thing about the tap water, though, is you get really, really close to some of these roots. There is no fur on the outside, no hyphae developing, or very, very little hyphae starting to develop. Some right here, you're starting to see it. Some of these roots are totally sterile. It's really the only way I could describe it. They're white. There's no fur, no hyphae development on some of the roots. On some of the other roots, they are beginning to develop right here. This third picture right here shows this one right here, the chlorine. These two are the Drops of Balance. Again, there are some plants out there that are easier to clone than others. These are tomato plants, but I'm just showing a reference right here. Once again, you zoom in real close to these plants, you can see that some of these have fur, but a lot of them don't. Then this is the chlorine. What does chlorine do, right? It voids your water or bioavailability. So what does the hyphae do? The hyphae is the communication. So voiding your soil or bioavailability means basically you just are shutting down the communication. So what's the communication? It's the hyphae. Right here with the Drops of Balance, you can see it's very clear. It's the Drops of Balance. It's the stuff on the bottom right here. Whenever there's stuff on the bottom of the water, you know it's going to be Drops of Balance is in there. It's just sitting in here. And as you can see right here, there's tons of hyphae growing right here. Tons of hyphae. Okay. My point is, once again, guys, is you can clone with just tap water. Although, what plants do you think are going to probably grow a little faster, be a little stronger? Is it going to be the Clonec ones that roots are barely developing? Is it going to be the tap roots that have nice, beautiful, white, sterile roots, but no hyphae communication being developed? Kind of like a child that's 4 or 5 that's still whining to get what it needs versus being able to communicate milk. Like my daughter, she sign languages to me and she says, more, more. You know what I mean? It blows my mind. She's been doing that for years now. Or do you think the plants that have the roots getting developed, their hyphae, their communication getting started, which plants do you think are going to do better? Some of these videos are super long, guys. I'm so sorry about that. But guys, this is years of my life of testing things, going through one by one, doing my due diligence before I start dropping my money on shit. And I take pictures and I record shit and I bring it into the future just to make sure I'm not lying to myself. I'm not creating a story, because at the end of the day, we're all susceptible to mental illness and we're all susceptible to our own stories that we create for ourselves, our own grand gestures. And some of the best, most humbling things you could ever do is call yourself out on your own shit. Please give me a thumbs up, like, share, and subscribe. Have a great grow, everyone.